We are living in the polymer world, from the clothes we wear, to the cars we drive, to the touchscreen OLED displays. Polymers are everywhere. There are too many aspects of polymers to discuss in one video, so we'll focus on one part, sports. Every sport played has changed to some degree thanks to polymers, be it protection, stuff like cricket, or in the playing surface, like hockey. In today's video, we'll look at how polymers have helped athletes get the edge over their opponents, how new materials have made athletes better and better, how polymers made the difference between failure and success. But first, we need to go all the way back to the beginning and find out what polymers are in Polymers in Sports, Gaining the Edge. First of all, what are polymers? Well, polymers are just really, really long chains of small molecules. There can be between 1,000 and 1,000,000 molecules in these chains. These molecules are called monomers. You can get polymers of just the same monomer, or they could be two or more different monomers, which may or may not have a repeating pattern. DNA is an example of a polymer with no repeating pattern. It's also an example of a natural polymer, a polymer that can be found in nature. The other types of polymers are synthetic polymers, which are man-made. For example, polyethylene is synthetic and is not going to be found naturally. Now that we know what polymers are, how are we going to make them? Well, to do that, you've got to react the monomers together in a polymerization reaction. There are two types of polymerization. One is chain growth or addition. Here, monomers have to have a carbon-carbon double bond that splits when reacted with to form a chain. This can be done in three ways: free radical, cationic, or anionic polymerization, though they all follow similar steps. Free radical, as the name suggests, needs a radical present before polymerization can start. Cationic needs an electrophile to start, and anionic needs a nucleophile. These are the initiators. They react with the monomer to make a new product. This then acts as an initiator for another monomer, a stage known as propagation. This is the stage that causes the long chains. Finally, chains have to terminate, which is slightly different for each method. In free radical, two radical chains react together to form one chain. In cationic, the chain could lose a proton or could be neutralized by a nucleophile. Anionic is slightly unusual. Provided there are no impurities or electrophiles, the reaction won't terminate. The chains will keep growing until there's no monomer left, and the carbanion will remain active. The other type is step growth or condensation polymerization. It usually involves two different monomers with a reactive functional group on each end of the molecule. These can be carboxylic acids, amines, acyl chlorides or alcohols, as well as more uncommon functional groups, such as isocyanate. These form chains by many condensation reactions between the different monomers to make the polymers, usually expelling a small molecule in the process. If a monomer has two different functional end groups that can react together, it can form a polymer made of the same monomer. So, now that we know how to make polymers, how can they be used to improve a sportsman's performance? Well, one of the best places to see this is at a major sporting event back in 2008. In February 2008, Speedo released a new swimsuit for the upcoming Olympics in Beijing, the LZR or Laser Racer. It was a full body suit and consisted of two layers. There was an inner layer which was made of a weave of two types of polymers, nylon and polyurethane, and an outer layer of polyurethane. These layers were then ultrasonically welded together. This resulted in a lightweight, more buoyant swimsuit which reduced drag from the water 24% more than other suits. Just by being in the suit, swimmers improved their times by on average 2%. In something like the 800 metres, this would be a 10 second improvement. At the Beijing Olympics, Rebecca Addington, wearing the Laser Racer suit, won gold at the 800 metre freestyle, having also already won the 400 metre. She also broke the world record for the 800 metre, which wouldn't have been broken had she not been wearing the suit. In fact, 98% of all medals won in the pool at Beijing and 23 out of 25 new world records were by people wearing the Laser Racer. By August 2009, people in this suit had broken 93 world records, with more broken by newer 100% polyurethane suits. The swimming governing body, FINA, declared that these types of suits were considered technology doping. They gave the swimmers an unfair advantage compared to other suits. They were then banned, with new regulations as well as new restrictions on how much of the body swimsuits were allowed to cover. So let's move on to a sport where players have benefited with the advent of polymers, the beautiful game itself. Polymers have really changed the dynamics of football. Some polyurethane polymers are also thermoplastic. They can be heated and moulded into a specific shape and solidified when cooled. This is done to make the sole of the boot. The top part of the boot is made of synthetic leather, a mixture of polymers of which polyurethane is an important part, or a mixture of synthetic leather and natural leather, which is normally kangaroo. Carbon fibre is also sometimes used, usually in the heel. It's not just the boot that's been improved. Footballs are now made from various polymers. The bladder, the inside part of the ball, is made of butyl rubber. Its job is to hold the air in the ball. The covering is made of polyurethane, which both protects the ball and reduces how much water can get in. Between these two layers are several linings of nylon, which helps to improve both the strength and bounce of the ball. All this makes the ball lighter and easier to hit. The introduction of these new materials helps improve football, but this is not the case in all sports. Sometimes, better materials reduce the enjoyment of the sport, such as tennis. Up until the mid-1960s, tennis rackets were made of wood. These weren't particularly powerful, and heads had to be small, as the string tension would be too much for anything larger. Then came stronger aluminium rackets. These allowed a larger head, and so the area to hit the ball and the sweet spot grew larger, allowing stronger and faster shots. While aluminium rackets are still in use, they are now composite rackets. These are layered around a hollow or polyurethane foam core and are usually fiberglass, graphite and boron or Kevlar. Ceramic, titanium and tungsten fibers can also be added to the composite. These materials allowed more powerful hitting of the ball and faster shots, eventually made shots too powerful. Matches became serve dominated with short rallies, returning people away from the sport. The International Tennis Federation decided to respond to this with the introduction of three types of tennis balls: fast, medium, and slow. The slower balls are larger and so experience more air resistance. They are played on fast courts, with the fast balls being played on slow courts. This slowed the serve and increased reaction time to return the ball. With the serve having less of an impact, rallies became longer and allowed players who had better stamina and endurance to rise to the top of the game. However, general shot strength has stayed pretty much the same, which has led to players playing mostly by the baseline without wanting to venture to the net too much. Polymers have been the driving force of legally improving athlete performance. This has led to technological arms races between manufacturers. Whilst often improving the sport, it has sometimes gone too far, and the governing bodies have had to rein in the pace of development and rebalance the sport. One thing's for certain though, polymers are still going to be a major influence in sport for generations to come. Thank you for listening.